Welcome to What the Experts Say on Coronavirus and Children, brought to you by the Leading Minds team at UNICEF Office of Research in Acenti. Please take the time to familiarize yourself with the webcast format. Please note, as a participant, your audio and video will be automatically muted. You will have the opportunity to ask questions via the text Q&A feature, and a selection of questions will be posed to the panelists during the session. This webcast is being recorded and will be available on the YouTube channel of UNICEF in Acenti. We trust you find today's webcast valuable.
Hello and greetings from UNICEF Office of Research in Acenti, and welcome to all our panelists and participants from around the world. I'm your host, David Anthony, and today on Leading Minds Online, we will be discussing COVID-19 and child labour. The COVID pandemic has hit children hard, keeping them out of school, away from friends and relatives, and limiting their movements. But it's also hurt them in other and often more hidden ways, one of which is child labour. Millions are at risk of entering child labour due to the pandemic, as family finances tighten and economic recession bites ever deeper. Equally alarming is that even before the pandemic, child labour was trending upwards. New global estimates released earlier this month by the International Labour Organization and UNICEF show that progress to end child labour has stalled for the first time in 20 years, reversing the downward trend that saw child labour fall by almost 100 million between 2000 and 2016. And this situation is likely to get worse unless we act now to protect children. 9 million children are at risk of falling into child labour by the end of 2022 due to the pandemic. And this figure could potentially rise to as much as 46 million unless adequate social policies are enacted and enacted fast. Can we put into place the necessary measures quickly enough to turn the tide and make up lost ground in the fight against child labour? These are some of the questions I'll be putting to our expert panelists today. Sadly, my regular co-moderator, Sarah Crowe, is unable to be here. So first, I just want to say on behalf of the Leading Minds Online team, Sarah, we missed you and we're looking forward to having you back shortly. And the screen is missing your absence. But happily, I am delighted to introduce my co-host for today, Ramya Subramanian, who is UNICEF in Acenti's Research Chief on Child Rights and Protection and deeply knowledgeable about today's topic. Ramya, welcome to Leading Minds Online. Your team is focusing on research in child labour and other protection issues. What are you personally hoping to hear from our panellists and participants today?
Thank you, David. And let me first join you in welcoming our panelists and participants. Indeed, at Acenti, we are working with partners in South Asia and Eastern and Southern Africa to study the potential of solutions to address this truly global challenge. I'm delighted to be co-moderating such a knowledgeable and eclectic expert panel. I do expect to learn a lot about both what's driving the issue of child labor and how we're going to meet the challenges posed by COVID-19. At the outset, I'd like to flag a few features of child labor that are highlighted in the recent ILO-UNICEF report that you mentioned. One, the largest share of child labor takes place within families, and this work is frequently hazardous. Two, girls' contributions are often hidden and undercounted, especially when it relates to domestic chores and care work. Three, migration is a key aspect of the rural to urban continuum of child labor. And finally, we need to focus on the boys and girls most at risk of exploitation. I look forward to coming in a bit later on in this program on the solutions, bringing to our panelists the questions that our participants from all over the world are asking us today. Back to you, David.
Thanks, Ramya. I'm also looking forward to hearing about the solutions in your segment later in the webcast and the answers to our intriguing poll and questions from the audience. You know, it struck me on reading the report, the ILO and UNICEF report, that although Africa is facing an especially challenging situation with child labour right now, owing in part to its youth bulge, almost every region of the world is also struggling with this, as is almost every sector, from agriculture to manufacturing, tourism to the informal economy. So we are delighted today to have such a distinguished panel of experts to help us delve deep into these issues. Starting in New York, Joe Becker, Advocacy Director of the Children's Rights Division at Human Rights Watch. Welcome, Joe. Moving north from New York, up the road at Dartmouth College in New Hampshire, Eric Edmonds, Professor of Economics. Thanks for coming, Eric. Switching continents to Africa, we turn to UNICEF's Chief of Child Protection in Ghana, Rafiq Khan. Welcome, Rafiq. And finally, here in the UK, we will shortly be joined by Virginia Messina, who is Senior Vice President at the World Travel and Tourism Council. Now, to set the scene, before we go to our experts, let's have a look at some of the very latest data on child labour, which are very alarming. Yeah, alarming data, indeed, really. I mean, given that half of the children between 5 and 17 are that make up half of the child labourers. Now over to our experts for a first snappy answer of 30 to 40 seconds to our opening question, which goes to all of them. And the question is, what is your biggest concern regarding child labour since COVID-19 began? I'm going to start with Joe Becker.
Thanks very much, and it's great to be with you today. I think from the earliest days of the pandemic, it was clear that there were risk factors that would spike child labor. Clearly, many families have been hit hard financially through job and income losses. An estimated 90 million people have been pushed into extreme poverty, which creates just incredible pressure on families to send their children to work. A second issue, of course, is over a billion children out of school, leaving them with little to do and feeling like they often, you know, that work is a logical alternative. A third factor is the rising death rates that have left hundreds of thousands of children without caregivers and breadwinners. And then finally, you know, reduced government inspections during COVID-19 restrictions, less monitoring, fewer enforcement of child labor laws. So, you know, all of these were foreseeable. And despite these obvious risks, you know, I'm concerned that many governments really haven't taken the necessary steps to respond and prevent an increase in child labor.
Thanks very much, Joe. On to Eric. What is your biggest concern regarding child labor since COVID-19 began?
So I think Joe did a great job of summarizing a lot of the issues that are on everyone's mind around what's happening to children during the pandemic. I think my concern is more what's going to happen after pandemic. I know there's a lot of attention right now and a lot of concern about, will these children go back to school? My hunch is that we'll all be pleasantly surprised at the excitement around school reopening, leading to a lot of kids coming back into contact with schools. And that might cause policy to think that this is not an issue to worry about going forward. But I think the other thing that's happened during COVID is families have worn down their ability to cope with the sort of crises and traumas that on a day-to-day basis are prevalent in the lives of the poor. So that what I expect is we'll see a lot more vulnerability after the pandemic ends than we would have been expecting to see during the normal progression of life prior to the pandemic. And my big concern is that the big rush back to school will turn off everyone's radar on these issues around kids, and that these worn down safety, personal safety nets won't be met with a rise in policy-based safety nets, and we'll have a lot of kids and a lot more crises going forward.
Thanks, Eric. And thanks for pointing out the kind of hidden dangers that can happen as even as we recover from COVID-19 in many parts of the world. On to you, Rafiq, the same question. What's your biggest concern regarding child labor since the pandemic began?
Well, thank you very much. I think Eric and Joe have, they have covered a lot of ground on this. One thing is for certain, the world as a whole and lower middle income countries in particular were not ready for this shock. Moving forward, however, the pandemic has taught us that the shock responsive approach to programming and development activities will help countries and communities mitigate, adapt to, and recover from shocks, thereby reducing losses, preventing downward spiral of dire investment, leading to loss of livelihood and increase in the number of children who are engaged in labor. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Rafiq. And Virginia, welcome. Virginia Messina, who's Senior Vice President of the World Travel and Tourism Council, welcome to Leading Minds Online. Virginia, what is your biggest concern regarding child labor since COVID-19 began?
Hi, David, and thank you for having me this afternoon. I mean, certainly it's been covered. It's obviously sort of around the rise of poverty and unemployment that will inevitably lead to more children being vulnerable and in this situation. So from a travel and tourism perspective, we believe we can be part of the solution. I mean, there is a big focus that governments will need to play. And going back to the concerns, I think where governments' focus is as we recover from this pandemic will be very important, and hopefully we'll get them to go back to sort of putting these networks and frameworks in place to avoid this issue.
Thanks, Virginia. Thanks to all the panelists for the first question. Really thought-provoking responses. Let's probe a little bit more. I'm going to start with you, Joe Becker, Advocacy Director, Children's Rights at Human Rights Watch. The 160 million figure on child labor for 2020 is alarming, but it only really tells part of the human cost of the issue. Your work, Joe, explores, amongst other things, how children experience child labor. What are children saying about the conditions on which they are under which they are laboring? And are we hearing differing perspectives between girls and boys?
Thanks, David. Early this year, in January and February, Human Rights Watch, together with partner organizations, conducted interviews with children in Ghana, Nepal, and Uganda. We wanted to document how the pandemic was affecting their lives and driving child labor. We talked with more than 80 children. Virtually every child described the negative economic impact on their families of the pandemic. Many of them saw their parents lose jobs, lose income, and struggling to meet their basic needs and to put food on the table. Many of them told us that they felt that they had no choice but to go to work to help their family survive. One of the things that really stood out to me was the degree of exploitation the children were experiencing, particularly the children that we spoke to in Uganda. They talked about working in hazardous conditions for very low wages. And even so, employers would come up with excuses to delay payment or to reduce their wages. One story that stuck with me was a 12-year-old girl that we interviewed in Uganda. She went to work at a stone quarry and was pounding stones for 7 hours a day, 6 days a week, and barely making a dollar a week. And even so, her employer would often pay her less if he was not happy with the size of the stones. Some of the children described working incredibly long hours, but still going hungry because their wages were not enough to pay for their food. You asked about the differences between girls and boys. We saw girls also in very hazardous work, working at gold mines and stone quarries, brick kilns, 14, 16 hour days in carpet factories in Nepal. Some of them told us about sexual harassment on the job and not having anywhere to complain. Others complained that they were paid less than boys despite doing the same work. but both boys and girls told us that they really felt trapped. One girl said, you know, she was experiencing violence and harassment by her employer and very low pay. But she said, I need the job, I need the money, however little. Thank you.
Thanks, Jo. And it's a tragedy in some ways, the stories that you described from Uganda. When we spoke before, I was struck by the point you made on how child labor also reflects the strength of a national systems of child welfare, including social policy, child protection, and education. How do you think these systems are coping with the stress imposed by the COVID pandemic, particularly in relation to child labor?
Great question, David. One of the things that is clear to us is that countries that have strong safety nets were much better prepared to deal with the impact of the pandemic than those without. For example, countries with expansive child allowance programs were better able to increase payments or add additional payments. Where those channels didn't exist, it was much harder for governments to channel emergency assistance to the families that needed it most. One of the reasons why we chose the three countries I mentioned for our research, Ghana, Nepal, and Uganda, was that each of these countries have made progress in the past on reducing child labor and reducing poverty. They're each a pathfinder country, which means that they've made an explicit commitment to accelerate their efforts to eradicate child labor. But compared to their peers in their regions, each of them was sort of lagging behind in terms of using cash transfers or cash allowances as a tool to respond to the pandemic and even before. And we know that this is a powerful policy tool. Between 2000 and 2016, you know, governments made remarkable progress in reducing child labor. Rates came down by nearly 40%. And we know that one of the key factors was the use of cash transfers or cash allowances. It can help reduce poverty, reduce child labor, increase school enrollment. It even reduces domestic violence. But in this wake of the pandemic, we've seen that the majority of governments have actually increased cash allowances, but often their efforts are, you know, falling short. We see a lot of short-term programs that average 3 months, for example, or consist of simply a single payment. And that's just not enough for many of the families that have been hit hard by the pandemic to, you know, weather the crisis. And I would just add one more point is that the pandemic has also exposed the weaknesses in our educational systems. They've exacerbated existing inequities, and under-resourcing has become even more acute during the pandemic, so that we see low-income students, for example, they've been most likely to be excluded from online learning because they couldn't access devices, the internet, or even electricity. And in our interviews, we found that many children said that they had no access to distance learning, and they rationalized that as long as they were out of school, they might as well go to work. And under-resourcing of education is also going to prevent many of these children from going back to school, even after the pandemic eases. So for example, some of the children that we interviewed told us that their schools had reopened, but they still hadn't gone back because they still needed to earn money to pay for their school expenses. And in Uganda in particular, school fees are a huge barrier. And it was really devastating to hear that some children had resigned themselves to never being able to go back to school and could only hope to earn enough to support the education for their younger siblings. So there's a lot that governments can do to strengthen these safety nets and strengthen educational systems to support children both in the short term and going forward. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Joan. We'll be back to you when we discuss solutions with Ramiro towards the end. I'm now going to go to Eric Edmonds, Professor of Economics at Dartmouth College. Eric, as the ILO-UNICEF report confirms, child labor numbers were beginning to rise long before the COVID pandemic struck. And at a time when global growth was strong and access to education was increasing across the world, what were and what are the key socioeconomic forces behind this alarming increase in child labor?
Thanks for the question, David. Whenever we talk about aggregate statistics and aggregate counts, I think it's always important to bear in mind that behind each one of those numbers are stories like the stories that Joe was just highlighting. And often when we talk about statistics, we lose sight of the people that are underneath them. And so in this case, you know, I think the focus on aggregate statistics can sometimes, in the debate about whether or not what we're measuring and are we actually measuring the trends that are being reported, lose sight that regardless of that debate, there are a lot of children in the world in crisis who need assistance. And there's a lot of good reasons to be worried about where that crisis is going to head in the post-COVID world. But to your specific question, you know, I'm not at all sure that there's been an alarming increase in child labor prior to the COVID pandemic, which says nothing about what we might expect subsequent to the pandemic. But it's important to think about, like, where do these estimates come from? Global estimates are based on a combination of counts, where we've got actual survey data, and imputations, which is a researcher making some guesses in places when we don't have actual survey data. And underlying these global trends are changes in the underlying data. We're not measuring the same thing over time. For economic activity, just for example, 10 years ago, we were asking people if they worked, whereas now we have kind of nuanced, defined questions like, have you helped your family with the livestock management in the last week? And so that's really important in understanding the new global counts, because the growth in the new global counts in child labor is coming from kids who are aged 5 to 11. And you could imagine that if you're a parent, because we don't talk directly to 5 and 11-year-olds in labor force surveys in general, you can imagine if you're a parent being asked, did your 8-year-old work? And all the child did was help you with pigs when you were out there tending livestock, you would say no to the question of did they work. But now the question is, hey, did your kid help you with the pigs last week? And now you say yes. And so with this change in data, where we're getting better at collecting the underlying data, we're going to capture more child labor. And we're especially going to capture more child labor in those sort of low intensity, infrequent activities, or in activities where parents wouldn't normally think of it as work. And so I don't get too worried about the global estimate numbers, especially when I see growth and child labor coming from there being more 5 to 11-year-olds working, when we don't really know what those activities are. I think that points to the value of, like, getting in, being actually attentive to what are the activities that our children are doing and where are they in particular doing. And so these aggregate numbers tend to mask that attention to the detail that really matters, to get at the kids who might be in crisis, like Joe highlighted. And I think that's one of the things that's really unfortunate here is, like, it would be great if in the global estimates, for example, we had some sort of, that's not in the report. So I feel like I don't know what's happening to the underlying global trends, but I'm also not too concerned about them. What I'm concerned about are the types of kids and the situations that Joe is talking about. And, you know, we need more data collection and more consistent data collection over time to really be able to track and say something about what's happening to those kids. But kind of broadly to your question of why do kids work, you know, we tend to see less child labor when poverty declines, because a lot of kids are working to help their family make ends meet. We know that when we see more crises, when we have more difficulties making those ends meet, kids are going to work more. But also if a family has transitory, you know, unique opportunities, or, you know, that might be beneficial or might be driven by a poverty crisis, they'll tend to bring everyone in the household to try to either take advantage of those opportunities or temper those crises. And we're going to see a lot of kids working in reaction to those sorts of stimuli too.
Thanks, Eric. I'm going to turn to social protection. It's another kind of economic issue that you're very familiar with and one that Joe has already mentioned. Social protection has grown enormously important as a policy tool in international development for improving a wide range of child rights, from nutrition to mental health. What can it really do to help reduce child labor? And if it's such a good tool, why are the numbers still so high in child labor, even in countries where social protection is gaining ground?
So that's an interesting question. I'm not sure the premise of the last part of the question is correct. Correlation is not causation by any means. And you could imagine you'd see a growth in people engaged in social protection and a growth in child labor because the same fundamental issues that are driving some families to be engaged in social protection, maybe driving some governments to expand social protection systems, might drive other families that are excluded from those resources to use more child labor. And the two are not in the aggregate necessarily at all linked. At the micro level, we've got lots of carefully done, carefully executed impact evaluations that allow us to say something about the impact of expanding social protection on child labor. And there, the evidence points to the importance of having nuance. You know, yes, in general, as families are less concerned about making ends meet, they then don't need to pull children in to help make ends meet, right? So as poverty declines, we see less child labor. But, you know, for kids to work, in the first place, there have to be economic opportunities for them to engage in. And so one of the things that can happen, especially in very, very poor settings, is that as the social protection allows households to begin to try things like their own businesses, like allows households to expand their farms, who are going to work in these small expanding businesses, who are going to work in these small expanding farms, often they'll bring family members in, and often the most available family member are kids. So when you think about systems like social protection, you're going to see different forces at work at the same time. Now, you might think, oh, well, we don't want families expanding the family farm and bringing kids into that. And that's why we kind of have to pay attention to the situation, because if what's happening is kids are brought into the family farm and are doing that, maybe in larger scale, but they're stopping some kids from really engaging in some of the truly horrendous situations that Joe described. Maybe that's something as a culture or a society we're willing to live with. But in the aggregate, it's really hard to know what we're talking about. And that's why it's really valuable to both, you know, collect detailed data and to pay attention to the nuance. Because sometimes, you know, especially when you're dealing with families that are on the margin of subsistence, like there's a lot of crises going on. They're more prevalent than you and I would ever face. And families are going to try to cope with them in the ways that are available to them. And so, you know, my hope, I think like what we've taken away from the literature is that we need to be attentive to the situation. And there are a lot of different trade-offs at play.
Thanks very much, Eric. I'm going to turn to Rafiq, UNICEF Chief of Protection in Ghana, to discuss child labor in Africa. Rafiq, Africa has the world's most youthful population with increasing numbers of children, but it's also seen a troubling increase in child labor in recent years. And agriculture has been a key area for this increased labor. From your country perspective in Ghana, what can you tell us are the key challenges to progress in eliminating child labor, and particularly in the cocoa industry?
Thank you, David. First of all, for viewers, I think it's important to understand that cocoa is an important commodity for Ghana's economy. As such, it is one of the largest foreign exchange earners for the country, around $2 billion every year. Over 800,000 households are connected with cocoa, majority of them being small farmers who have to resort to intensified agriculture to improve cocoa yields for their income. And then we turn to what is the situation on the overall child labor in Ghana. One in five children in Ghana are engaged in child labor, and three in four children who are engaged in child labor are actually working in agriculture, forestry, or in fishing. Cocoa sector or cocoa supply chain as a whole involves around 750,000 children, and that is according to a latest survey that was conducted by the University of Chicago, funded by the U.S. Department of Labor. Out of those, 710,000 are those children that who work in hazardous working conditions. Hazardous working conditions on a cocoa farm means that you're working with sharp tools or closer to the pesticides or other dangers that can be harmful for the health of children. There are two interesting things that I want to put on the table. One is that overall number of children that who are exclusively working in Ghana actually has been going down over the years. But the number of children that who are mixing work with labor, with education has actually increased. So which means that there are children that who are missing school just because they are working. And that is more so in the cocoa growing areas in Ghana. And this is despite the fact that no cocoa farmer in Ghana wants their children to work on the cocoa farm. That's absolutely something that has come out in each and every survey that has been conducted in Ghana. Now, there are two key challenges that I want to highlight. Those challenges have not been highlighted by Joe and by Eric. And those challenges are around education and labor economics. I think there are dynamics which are around that, other than the poverty question and other than the social protection related question. It is not always about poverty of the farmer, especially the cocoa farmers in Ghana are actually a bit better off than the most vulnerable Ghanaians. And this is very much evidenced from the inclusion of people in the social safety net program of Ghana, which is the cash transfer program. There are very few farmers, cocoa farmers, who are part of that program. Mostly it is the other parts of Ghana where cocoa is not grown that they are part of those social safety net programs. Number two is that education is crucial to breaking the cycle of child labor. But as long as cultivation and harvesting of cocoa requires more labor, there is no incentive for the cocoa farmer to send their children to school because it makes more sense to have them used as labor, because cocoa production is labor intensive. And one thing which I want to say is that the education is not always about money. In Ghana, primary and secondary school education actually is free. And government has done a wonderful job in resourcing that as well. Of course, there are always improvements which are required, but over the last 4 or 5 years, there have been increased investment on education. Evidence from Ghana shows that high level of absenteeism correlates with harvesting period in cocoa producing areas. Why is that the case? Simple. Planters, they just need more labor. So these are the two issues that I feel that we need to look at. And then when we come to the solutions, I'll be providing a few suggestions around that as well. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Rafiq. I'm just going to then, having you said that, I'm just going to ask you one more question if you could answer in just 1 minute. Are there any new and innovative approaches being tried to stem the rising tide of child labor in Ghana? Just give us an example of one.
Yeah. So it is clear from the Human Rights Watch report and ILO, UNICEF estimates, and within Ghana, the assessments have been conducted that the child labor is on the rise, but that may not necessarily be due to the poverty and other factors. So there are a couple of things which are happening in Ghana. There is a large scale investment which is currently going on for diversifying the income of farmers. I think that's a wonderful way to eliminate child labor. Number two is making sure that all the pesticide use on the cocoa farms is actually centrally contracted by the government of Ghana, so that you eliminate the number of children that who are actually working in hazardous working conditions. So Cocoa Board is an agency which contracts vendors that who actually go around and spray all the cocoa pods or all the cocoa plantations. However, there are, as indicated, there are challenges still with that, but these two things I feel are, if they're scaled up, they could potentially have wonderful consequences for children. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rafiq. I'm going to turn now quickly to Virginia Messina, Senior Vice President of the World Trade and Tourism Council. Virginia, your organization is influencing action to address child economic and sexual exploitation in the tourism and travel sector. As this sector reopens, the concern is that COVID-19 has expanded the number of children in conditions of great poverty and vulnerability who are now available for labor, particularly those in those hazardous and hidden forms of labor. What can be done to reverse this?
Sure, David. So First of all, I would just like to sort of put into context that our sector is a huge employer. So back in 2019, we were responsible for over 330 million jobs in the planet. That's about one in every 10 jobs in our sector. So, and we are also a very high employer of women and youth. So about 53% of our employees are either women or about 30% youth. However, these are obviously quality jobs and jobs that bring positive a positive impact to the communities when it comes to reducing poverty and actually increasing education and others. Now, sadly, as it's been mentioned today, we know that with COVID-19, all of these issues have been exacerbated and actually minorities have been disproportionately affected, right? And that's where we leave all of these children that have been out of school and all of the things that we've covered that are more vulnerable. So from a travel and tourism perspective, I mean, we are a sector that manages the movement of people. And as such, we have a responsibility to protect the individuals we serve, we transport, we accommodate, and we employ. So in this context, we've been having conversations and joining forces with other organizations to try to bring some tangible solutions to ending this crime. I mean, and if this crime is also very linked to human trafficking, actually, it's kind of our biggest focus, which I know is not exactly the same, but actually some of the solutions are similar. So in conversations with our over 200 members from the private sector, again, we believe we can be part of the solution. So we've come up with a framework of the things that need to be done. What is it that we're doing? We're trying to raise awareness, right? Raising awareness of the issue continues to be very important. Education and training is relevant when it comes to travelers, but also when it comes to employees of our businesses to be able to identify these cases and also understand prevention efforts. Advocacy with governments to try to enact and enforce legislation that will avoid this issue, and also support when it comes to some of these potentially children or family. So that's kind of the framework we're working towards. But we also believe that sort of public and private collaboration is essential. Governments obviously have a very important role to play in all of this, and us from the private sector as well in conjunction with that.
Thanks, Virginia. And we're going to go to the solution section. I think Rami's going to ask you a little bit more about what businesses can do to reverse child labor in that section, how they can work better with government agencies and civil societies and vice versa. I want to thank all so much to all four of our panelists, and I'm going to pass it over to you, Rami, now for you to answer the poll question and then to go into the solution section. I'm intrigued by this poll question, Rami. So over to you, please.
Thank you. Thank you, David. And thank you really to all our panelists who have really highlighted a wide range of issues, pointing to the complexity of the issues we're talking about today and the need for action on multiple fronts. But what actions should be prioritized? Which actors need to be involved? So to really take us forward in this segment of this discussion, we're first placing our global participants in the position of decision making and asking you to respond to a poll. So imagine that you are a minister of labor and social affairs of a country with rising numbers of child labor since the pandemic began. Which of these would you consider your most promising strategy to reverse this trend? One, reopening schools accompanied with mass campaigns to persuade all children to return to education, or at least make education a component of their lives alongside work if that's necessary. Expand social protection initiatives, including universal child benefits, to provide households with financial incentives to stop and reverse child labor. Three, support fiscal measures to boost economic growth, and ensuring that maybe the market forces perhaps generate decent work opportunities for adults so that the children can get out of work. Four, invest in child protection systems, agricultural development, rural services, infrastructure, livelihoods, the sort of enabling environment. And five, form a national alliance against child labor, bringing together government, municipalities, business, and others who work together. So unfortunately, you don't get to say all of the above, so you will have to make the challenging choices there. But we look forward to seeing what our audience thinks about where the actions really need to be focused. And as we get the answers, I'd be happy to see the results come up on the screen so we see what our audience really thinks.
And in the meantime, the poll question is always really interesting. We always give our audience just a little minute or so just to see what they think. And if you can just answer the question, as Ramya said, and in a few seconds, we'll find out what it will be. Over to you, Ramya.
Thank you. And while we're waiting for the poll questions to come up, and I request that they come up as soon as we have them, I just would like to recommend to people to read the ILO UNICEF report that's just come out so that we get a kind of a sense of the scope and the issues that we're talking about. And hopefully this will give rise to more of the detailed research that Eric was talking about, that we need to see really diving deeper into those stories, into those national level contexts, so we really understand the context specific solutions that we need to find. So could I have the solutions up as yet, the poll responses up as yet? Aha. So I just very interesting that the social protection response has gathered the most amount of responses, about 39%, followed by the investment in an enabling environment, the child protection systems and agricultural development, the rural public services, and then followed by really multi-party action, alliances, bringing together different sectors to work together collectively to address this issue. And somewhat maybe surprisingly, David, to me, is that the reopening of schools really got a very small response. But I think nobody would disagree that it's a very important part of our arsenal, if you like, of solutions. So I'm going to build off those poll results and really go back to social protection, since that's what our audience seems to be most interested in. But I want to change the focus a little bit, because I think we've spoken a lot about the potential of social protection. But we also have questions in the Q&A which say, well, is it enough? You know, what do we do? How does social protection really reach workers in the most informal sectors, migrant populations, and those engaged in those hazardous forms of child labor? You know, some of the people, Joe, that you spoke to, are cash transfers really going to help on their own? What else do we need to see? What are some of those complementary interventions that we need to be adding to social protection? And perhaps I'll start with you, Joe, because you did raise this issue at the very beginning that you don't think governments are doing enough. So could you tell me maybe one or two top points that you'd like to add to the social protection kind of solution, if you like, which you think would be most effective at this time?
Sure. Thanks, Ramya. And I'd like to pick up on a point that Eric made a little while ago, that when you look at social protection, the nuance is really important. Not all social protection programs are equal. And there's a lot of research that shows that those that have the biggest impact have three criteria. One is the number of families that are covered. Second is the size of the allowance. It needs to be enough to really make a difference to help families meet their needs. And then the third is the regularity of payments. Families need to be able to depend on the fact that they can get these payments month after month. And there's also a lot of research that shows that universal programs are really beneficial compared to targeted programs that have, say, means testing to identify the poorest families. What we've discovered about these targeted programs is that they often leave out the families that need them the most, and that there's a lot of stigma attached, and families are often reluctant to apply for these programs because they feel like they may be stigmatized in their communities. So I think when it comes to social protection, we need governments to really be smart about using the resource, the research that exists, to make them as effective as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. So coverage, size of benefit, regularity, all of these matter, and the way in which these transfers are delivered are really important to including more and more people. And I think that is, to a great extent, what the evidence is starting to show, that I do think we need to learn a lot more, perhaps, about those contexts and those features that are really going to make a difference, whether universal or not, to reach children. So thank you for that. And I'm going to turn to Rafiq also on social protection, Rafiq, because in our earlier call, you had mentioned that social protection is one of the four pillars of action for the cocoa industry in particular. And perhaps you can tell us again one or two things that you see have to happen and in an accelerated way for social protection to really be the game changer that people seem to think it is.
I think in the questions, as well as Ramia and Joe, you have highlighted social protection alone is not going to do everything. It has to, we need to look at the solutions which are multifaceted solutions. So if it is the social protection, then we also need to look at, for example, in the case of cocoa farmers, can we look at the diversification of their income? Can we look at more innovative ways of increasing productivity? A Ghanaian farmer, for example, cultivates 500 kilograms per hectare, but a farmer in Southeast Asia or East Asia, cultivates 1500 kilograms per hectare of cocoa. So there's a massive, massive difference. And then can we bring some more innovation in terms of how do we pick the cocoa pods, how we break them, how we dry them, how we ferment them? So that piece is on the living income of the farmer that can be improved, which should be supported through social protection, but then by the market forces as well. On top of that, it is extremely important that there are infrastructures within the cocoa growing areas or agriculture areas where children are engaged that support quality education for children that are living in those areas. Plus the other services, health and nutrition, and the birth registration related services. It is the investment in all these areas together that has shown that the child labor can be defeated. And this is not something that, you know, is a general statement. This is something which is documented in the NORC study report, which came in 2020. More integrated services, the better impact on the reduction in child labor, not just one or two interventions. Thank you.
Thank you, Rafiq. And I think that's also a really important point that we need to see these as a kind of a package rather than just picking one intervention as a sort of magic bullet. And I think that would be probably borne out and agreed with by all our speakers. And I'm going to then turn, because you mentioned education amongst other things, that even though in our poll that didn't come through so strongly, we do know that keeping children in school is a very big protective factor, right? And not just keeping them in school, but obviously keeping them learning and in very inclusive and appropriate school environments. So we're really seeing that connection, particularly now with schools being closed in many places or unequal access to remote learning. That's also a kind of a driver in a way of child labor in the COVID context. So I'm going to just perhaps focus specifically on the age group of 15 plus, because this seemed to be of interest also to our audience and to some of the questions that came in earlier. And this is the group, the 15 plus children who are often not protected by compulsory education laws, for example, who will be transitioning into the workforce. And this is a critical moment for them. And Eric, you spoke about the kind of post-pandemic scenario as well, and the fact that we shouldn't just think that when schools open, things will be fine. What can we do more for that age group to really strengthen the completion of education and transition in a safe and a positive way to the workforce with the skills they need? So Eric, could I maybe ask you first to tell us a little bit more if you think that what needs to happen to really protect this group of children who are really in that transitional stage that's so important? And what would you prioritize for that age group? So over to you, Eric.
That's a challenging question. I would say, you know, when we're thinking of children, the definition of what is childhood can be context specific. You know, 100 years ago, the concept of adolescence didn't even exist. When you're dealing with 15 to 17 year olds, you're going to have some places where those 15 to 17 year olds are transitioning into their adult life. And I think when we view their allocation, their time allocation and the child labor related issues in a context where that's at a transition stage, we want to be thinking about how can we help support their transition into opportunities that are going to have the potential for growth over time. And so I think, you know, that instantly starts you thinking about things like vocational education. And we really don't have very good skill sets with which to advise policymakers on how to target vocational education in that population that help them transition into just not remedial jobs, but jobs that have opportunities for growth and an opportunity in 100 years, or not in 100 years, 20 years. Now, there are a lot of other places, though, where 15 to 17-year-olds aren't on the cusp of transitioning to adulthood, where they're still very much children, and where the problem for them is how to help, even though they're very capable earners, how to help them stay in school and complete education so that they have a full set of opportunities going on. And then that sort of ties into a lot of the work that we've got around how to encourage people to stay in school. And I think the best evidence we have is that if you can reduce the importance of crises in their lives, that'll and make schooling accessible and affordable, you can help those kids try to stay in school. So I would say, like, overall, when we start talking about 15 and 17-year-olds, we could have very different policy prescriptions in different countries that are appropriate for the reality that exists on the ground today. Unfortunately, like, that's not a group that we're studying very much. And especially in the child labor sphere, we're really focusing a lot more on the 14 and under group.
Yeah, so thank you, Eric. And I think the point about evidence is also well taken. I think we need to really invest much more in understanding these issues better as well to come up with those appropriate policies. Virginia, I'm going to turn to you because, as you mentioned, the travel and tourism industry is a large employer, particularly of young people. And, you are also trying at the same time to invest in protecting children who are, at risk of exploitation within travel and tourism. And at the same time, you talked about building opportunities and being part of the solution. So what would you perhaps bring to us on the solutions end about what you think needs to happen and how the private sector can also play a role in supporting governments to realize what Eric is also talking about, the opportunities, not just working to survive?
Sure. So, I mean, I think first of all, the most important is kind of that partnership. I mean, we know that, I mean, government, private sector and civil society really need to work on this together. And that's the best chances we're going to have to tackle some of these issues. I mean, from the government perspective, I think it's obviously sort of tackling what the root of the problem is. So the drivers such as poverty, homelessness, food insecurity, and all of the things that have been mentioned. I mean, although some of these issues and some of these children being exploited happens on the private sector. So what is the role that the private sector can play? How can we address this? I think there's a number of companies, and again, we work with the sort of biggest brands, such as sort of American Express, Marriott, a number of different hospitality brands that are conscious that this can be an issue and therefore have developed frameworks to, again, identify that this issue can happen and to avoid this happening within their facilities, to train employees to know where and how this issue could be taking place without others noticing it. So raising that awareness and also reporting is important, right? That those networks are in place for either an employee or even just a consumer to be able to report this potentially. So I think, again, it has to be in collaboration. It has to be in collaboration with the private sector on our end, but also the government enacting and enforcing legislation, policies, and of course social protection and other support that can be provided. We have seen a number of positive examples. For example, Egypt, the Ministry of Tourism was recurrently conducting inspections across their hotels to ensure compliance with regulation to prohibit the entry of children that could be vulnerable to sex or labor trafficking. So again, this is very linked to that issue, but some governments have very mechanisms to be able to identify this issue and at least to be conducting inspections to be able to do that. But ultimately, I think it's that sort of public-private partnership that is really going to help, because we both have a role to play in order to address this.
Thanks, Virginia. Maybe I can ask you in a minute to maybe say something about addressing the opportunities and skills building also. I think you've spoken very powerfully to the importance of the protective and the safeguarding of children which I think is obviously a very important role that the industry plays. But could you say something a little bit about skills development and opportunities, safe opportunities for young people in the travel and tourism sector? Is there other initiatives that also look at that, so they're not working in exploitative or hazardous conditions?
I mean, absolutely. That's exactly our focus. And we actually have seen our research, because we do a lot of research, and we've also partnered with an organization called the Social Progress Imperative, which is literally looking at the social impact and social development. And there are direct linkages. So in the communities where travel and tourism has a strong presence, we know there's a direct link to the social progress. And that means the development of the social side of the prosperity, of education, the less poverty. And so all of those indicators are impressed. There are direct linkages. And when it comes to skills, travel and tourism is a very diverse sector. So we represent a number of different industries, whether it's hospitality, whether it's aviation, whether it's tour operator, travel agent. So it's very broad. And as such, the skills can be broad as well. We can develop all sorts of skills in a positive way, and in a way that reflects positively to the community, that develops the community, and that provides social welfare overall. So I think absolutely that continues to be our focus, and those sort of quality jobs and that prosperity that travel and tourism brings.
Thank you, Virginia. And actually, we're actually almost out of time. So I'm going to ask all our four panelists, so thank you so much for your reflections and thoughts. But there's one question that came from a participant, but I think was also spoken to at the beginning, which is, we are going to be increasingly in a world where disruptions like the pandemic, we've got climate change also causing disruptions, and we can anticipate that we're going to live in this kind of world of uncertainty to a great extent. What is one lesson we can learn, both from the COVID-19 responses and gaps, as we look towards the future? So maybe just one or two keywords, please. And maybe, Virginia, I'll start with you. Just one or two key words that you want to leave us with.
Not a self-advocate, but for us is the importance of travel and tourism when it comes to the social side. So we have seen a rise in mental health issues, in social issues, domestic violence, all of these issues as a result of lockdowns and people not being able to travel to connect with their loved ones and to connect with other cultures. So it kind of raises the importance of our sector, not just as an economic force, but also socially.
Wonderful. I'm going to pass to Rafiq with the same question. Two, three keywords. What is one lesson that you would like to leave us with from this time?
Thank you. When we're building back, we need to build it in a way that our systems are more shock responsive. So they're able to absorb the shocks. In terms of cocoa supply chain, we should not just be focusing on due diligence. We need to look at more comprehensive multi-sectoral intervention that address, look at the child in a more comprehensive manner. Thank you.
Thank you. Wonderful. Joe?
Well, I don't think that there's just one intervention. And, participants have been pointing out in the chat that there's no one single solution. So I just want to highlight that we need a holistic response that includes at least three components. One is scaling up cash allowances to help families who are experiencing financial pressure. Secondly is getting children back into school as soon as possible, removing their financial barriers and adding incentives such as free school meals to encourage school attendance. And then finally, vigorous enforcement of child labor laws. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. And Eric, I think you get the final word. One or two keywords, please.
Yeah, to the points that the other panelists have added, I would emphasize that we have an opportunity as the pandemic ends to learn retrospectively through intense data collection, who were the most vulnerable? Who were the ones that didn't have a means to cope with this particular trauma? And I think that's a really important lesson to learn so that when we have future shocks like this, we know who to target for emergency relief, for emergency services, because we're not going to be able to help everyone all the time. So I hope that this crisis will be an opportunity to learn a little bit about who is most vulnerable to this type of crisis.
Thank you so much, Eric. This has been our solutions focus. David, I'm going to hand back to you.
Thanks very much, Ramya. Before we wrap up, Ramya, I'm curious to hear your takeaways from the session in 30 seconds.
Oh, that's going to be difficult, David, but I'll try. I just think we've had so much, but I think in a way it's all come together really well in terms of all the panelists really taking us to some very key points. So I won't repeat them, but I do think that one of the issues that is always present when we talk about children is the children need to be in the room. They need to be listened to. They need to be heard. We need to hear their voices and experiences. And I think that's something that I would definitely say is what we didn't talk about, but it should be there. And I think the other issue is that when I looked at the audience questions, there is so much knowledge that people still are seeking about what works. And I think we need to step up our efforts to really provide the evidence-based solutions and information to the wider community, really. Over to you.
Oh, thanks, Ramya. Great points. And thanks for being a fabulous co-moderator. I would also like to thank our wonderful panel, Joe Becker, Eric Edmonds, Rafiq Khan, and Virginia Messina for their insightful and stimulating contributions. And also to you, our loyal audience, for tuning in and asking the thought-provoking question every month. We'll be back in the autumn to continue the Lead in Mind Online series. So from myself, David Anthony, and from Ramya Subramanian and the Lead in Minds team, have a great rest of your day and see you in September. Goodbye.